I am so honored to be here to celebrate with you today. And I'd like to take one more moment to congratulate you on your magnificent achievement. Could we hear just one more round of applause for you? And now, you graduates, I'd like for you to have the opportunity to raise the roof in gratitude for your friends, your family, and for the USC faculty that loved you, supported you, and let's be frank, tolerated you at times to get you to this point. So thank you, family. Serious stuff. When I got the email inviting me to be your commencement speaker, I did what all of us do when we get an email like that, some crazy thing. You take your cursor up and you hover over the thing to see what scammer has decided to fill up your inbox with things that never happen. And it came on behalf of the leadership, but through my friend and esteemed colleague, Dr. Chen. He doesn't play jokes, not on me anyway, so I followed up with him, and the whole process of confirming that this opportunity was real made me realize that I instinctively said yes, internally. I didn't say that to him, but internally I said, are you kidding me? Absolutely yes. Well, I am prone to self-examination, introspection. I'm not gonna go all Socratic on you, but I pretty much did. It's like, why did I know right away that this was something I wanna do? I'm not on the commencement speaker circuit. So this was new and this was scary. I didn't go to USC. I don't know any of you. I don't think I know any of you personally, but the feeling I had was one that was intensely personal. Yes, I'm in. So a couple nights later, in the middle of the night, I found myself saying, why did I say yes? Not in the manner of, why did I say yes? But what drove me so quickly to be sure this was the right thing to do? So what did I do? It's what everybody in public health does. You do an environmental scan. You start interviewing what we call SMEs, right? Subject matter experts. So I polled leadership up here to get to know you better. To understand the world that you've been living in. And I will tell you, I did a pretty much deep dive into my own roots. And I have come up with reasons that I am here. I'm gonna walk you through those in a minute, but I also want you to know that another question that came up quickly was, what can I bring? What can I bring you all today? And thanks to all of my colleagues, my new family up here on the stage, I'm bringing you a gift. And I'll tell you what it is, we'll come back to it at the end, but what it is an image, and I've started thinking about it as a little tattoo. It's a little brain tattoo or heart tattoo, depending on where you think your guidance comes from. But I'm gonna give you that tattoo at the end, I'll give you a hint. The tattoo's name is Polly. So where did this alignment, this resonance of pharmacy and pharmacists with me come from? I was born in the land of cotton. I was born in the land of the blues, blue suede shoes, and what I now know in public health speak is a large and disproportionate burden of chronic conditions, chronic disease. The good news, the luck for me, is that I was born into a team. My father was a primary care doc. My mother was his nurse. They practiced in my little hometown of 3,200 people for over 50 years on the Arkansas side of the Mississippi Delta. And I grew up answering the phones in Wright Clinic at nights, weekends, holidays, when the real receptionist was home trying to recover from the previous work week. But the family I grew up in, or the team I grew up in, didn't even begin to end there. There was the ambulance driver who lived across a cotton field from us, no kidding. His name was Flash. I kid you not, Flash, the ambulance driver, his name Flash. But he took the emergencies, the people who were in dire straits, the gunshot wounds, the cotton gin accidents, the crowning baby, off to the hospital, which was miles away. But one of my favorite team members, and here is where the resonance comes from, was Mr. Crook. Mr. Crook was our town's pharmacist, and with his wife, they were proud owners of the Rexall Pharmacy, and they were on call 24/7. He and she delivered prescriptions for people who couldn't get into the store. They problem solved with folks who needed medications and couldn't afford them. They also kept my dad up to speed with what I now know was academic detailing. Yes, even back then. Mr. Crook supported the football team and the Future Farmers of America, and he bought a big Rexall sign for the outfield fence of the baseball field. He and his wife served his fellow Methodists as an in-pew health expert, just like my parents did for the Presbyterians. So I'm not taking you through my past history out of some warm, fuzzy nostalgia for the good old days. First of all, they weren't all good. My little town depended heavily, in fact, almost solely on agriculture. So a bad crop year meant lean times for everyone, the farmers and their families, small business owners, teachers, and of course the farm workers themselves. These traumas always hit hardest for those who have the least to begin with. In the early years, Wright Clinic was segregated. I remember overhearing my parents' late night kitchen table decision to abolish that separation, to create one waiting room, one set of exam rooms, and a single door. They were afraid, they were worried, that white patients would go elsewhere, and they did it anyway. They did their best to practice with no quality measures. Some of us would say that's a really good thing and we never should have had those, but they had no quality measures. They had no data systems to track prevalence of disease. It was high. Or control rates, it was low. But they did their best. It's fair to say that although health was poor for everyone, it was not equally experienced. Health and healthcare were not the same on both sides of the track. So too for the seasonal farm workers who bust in and out of town during planting or harvest seasons. Despite all these challenges, these people, these models for me, my folks, Flash and Mrs. Flash, the Crooks, my residents of my hometown, enjoyed a luxury that is in short supply today. And that luxury, that asset, is trust. Trust. That trust is a sacred bond between individuals. It's between teams and the people they're caring for. Trust feeds the caregivers, and it comforts those who are receiving care. Trust makes care work. Though waning for decades, long before the pandemic, trust in institutions, government included, has plummeted over the last 3 years. And yet, in this environment, rife with mistrust and distrust, during your training, you stood up mass vaccination clinics and administered 1.5 million COVID vaccinations, serving some, I hear it's like 10,000 people a day in Dodger Stadium. You volunteered with CORE, the community organized relief effort. You led and served in teams, in community. You earned, you built, and you built back trust. It's fitting because you belong to a profession that has earned and honored the public's trust. It's also fitting that you will now carry forward a degree from a university planted deeply by intention, by design, by purpose in its community. Your experiences here, the actions you've taken, the lessons you've learned and the relationships you've formed are the treasures that will shape your future. Let's talk about your future. I'll be straight with you. I would love for all of you to specialize in preventing heart disease and stroke, the nation's number one and number five killers, the major cause of maternal mortality and morbidity. I'd also like you to put at the top of your list the equitable detection and control of hypertension, affecting 1 in 2 American adults. Based on personal experience and a mountain of evidence, much of which generated by the California Wright Meds Collaborative, led by Steve Chin, I know that you excel at this. You excel at chronic condition detection and management. So please, do that. Whatever health challenges you decide to tackle, please serve at that interface between healthcare and health. It's where population health lives. Whether it's in a community-based pharmacy where your teams can be of the community and best positioned to serve the community, or perhaps in companies that are innovating for a better future, in a health department, or perhaps come and join me in federal service. I know many of you have already locked into place your next professional adventure, some very confident, deep and abiding confidence in you're doing the right thing, but there are probably others of you who have some indecision, some trepidation about your next steps, and rightly so. After all, you have just come through, as many speakers have already mentioned, and we don't need to, you've come through a once in 100 years pandemic. It is absolutely right for you to question your professional priorities, for you to think deeply about your personal goals. All of us who survived the pandemic have a new lens. We bring a new lens to defining our purpose on the planet. So as one who's bounced around from her original plan to be a journalist, I wanted to be Barbara Walters when she was on the Today Show, to cardiology, to a stint in association leadership, a stint, that's an inside joke, right? And now federal service in public health, I'll wager right here today that you too will reinvent yourself. As you ricochet from the bumps and bruises from life and the delights and the discoveries, you too will redefine your purpose along the way. You'll find your highest good over and over. You too will leap, perhaps several times in the decades ahead. So I'm getting to the present. What could I bring you today? What can I give you to keep in your back pocket in case you need it as you're making decisions in the future? Polly was the first bird dog I ever knew. You see, in addition to healthcare, my family were hunters, and Polly was our leader. At the age of 7, I was spellbound when she caught the scent of a bird. Her head held high, her nostrils flaring. You could tell her heart was pounding, but she was stock still, except for a little quiver in her legs. Whether she was crashing through the brush to flush a covey of quail, or splashing through a lake to retrieve a downed bird, Polly knew her mission, and she was wholly committed to it. She completely trusted her senses, and she lived her purpose on every single hunt. She reveled in it. Now, I can go on and on about Polly being a critical and unique team member with specialized skills and training, and how without her, the Wright family and our neighbors would never have known the pleasures of a duck or quail dinner. But all of that is obvious. The lesson I learned from Polly and I apply to my own decision-making even today, pay attention when you catch a scent. Be still and listen to that. Is your heart pounding? Does that scent focus your mind and make your heart race? Track that path, follow that trail, trust your instincts, and take a leap. As I close, my wish for you, the class of 2023, is a deep, deeply fulfilling and long career filled with lots of chapters. A career in which you build and join and lead teams that help you serve the mission and the people that make you quiver. I have no doubt you will help communities all across the nation and the globe get well and stay well. Now let's get those diplomas and get going. Thank you.